Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. Thank you for coming out to our Space in Hollywood panel about space habitats and living environments versus Hollywood fiction, the designs for the future. My name is Connie Reese, and I manage Northrop Grumman Communications for NASA's James Webb Space Telescope, which will unleash a new dawn of discovery when it launches in late 2018. And so one of the exciting aspects of my job is having an opportunity to do a lot of public outreach, a lot of collaboration with the entertainment industry, working on various film projects and documentary films, and also working in the virtual reality world and looking into ways that we can utilize that type of technology about for telling the story of space and exciting others about space exploration. So welcome, we're glad to have you, and I have the pleasure of introducing some of our esteemed panelists here today. We will start with Dr. John Ehrenberg, Chief Engineer of the James Webb Space Telescope for Northrop Grumman. In this role, Dr. Ehrenberg leads engineering and development of space science missions at the Space Park Center of Excellence at Northrop Grumman Aerospace Systems, a premier provider of manned and unmanned aircraft, space systems, and advanced technologies critical to our nation's security and advancement of the science. In his current role, Ehrenberg leads engineering for Northrop Grumman Aerospace Systems Space Systems Science Missions, developing, planning, and conducting strategic analysis for various NASA astrophysics missions, including the James Webb Space Telescope. He is responsible for directing Northrop Grumman studies of potential successor missions to the Webb Telescope. And in his previous role, Ehrenberg led the development of optical, space, and laser systems as the lead engineer. With 28 years of experience working on astronomical programs such as the Chandra X-ray Observatory, development of the Starshade, and NASA's James Webb Space Telescope. So welcome, John. We also have Dr. Jacqueline Ford Morey, founder and chief scientist with an MS, MFA, PhD with degrees in both art and computer science. Dr. Morey has 25 years of experience in developing innovative techniques for rich, emotionally evocative virtual reality environments. As part of this pioneering work, she invented a scent collar to bring the emotional power of smell to immersive experiences. And she developed new types of functions for VR, such as connections to multiple sensors and feedback systems to make VR more effective. Dr. Morey spent 13 years as a senior research scientist at USC's Institute for Creative Technologies, which she helped found. While there, she created novel VR telehealthcare activities using her deep understanding of art, computer animation, and human behavior to enhance patient engagement with these programs. In the mid-1990s, she started comprehensive computer animation training programs at Walt Disney, feature animation combining art and technology topics, which she later expanded to the special effects industries at studios such as Rhythm and Hughes. Welcome, Dr. Morey. We also have Mr. Pete Blumel, co-founder and CEO and creative director for the Rogue Initiative. He's a producer, creator, and designer of real-time, story-driven, immersive entertainment with 21 years of experience in feature film, animation, and blockbuster AAA interactive production. Prior, he served in a key producer role for 8 years as Activision's Infinity Ward game development studio, where he became intimately involved as the co-creator of Call of Duty, Modern Warfare series, and Ghost videos. Video games, utilizing his filmmaking background to bring more high-end cinematic production values and immersive real-time storytelling to the Call of Duty franchise, which has since come to characterize the long-running series, earning a combined near $4 billion in worldwide grosses and winning countless awards, including 3 BAFTAs. Before joining Call of Duty founders, Blumer spent 10 years at DreamWorks SKG, first as DreamWorks for feature animation technology and later at Amblin Entertainment. And last but not least, we have Dr. Pascal Lee, who is the chairman of the Mars Institute, a planetary scientist at the SETI Institute, and the director of NASA Houghton Mars Project at NASA Ames Research Center. He holds an M.E. in geology and geophysics from the University of Paris and a Ph.D. in astronomy and space sciences from Cornell University. Lee's research focuses on Mars, in particular, the history of water on Mars and the origin of Mars's moons. He is also internationally recognized for his work on planning the future human exploration of Mars and for his contributions to the design and development of spacesuits, rovers, aircraft, and habitats for Mars. Lee was a scientist pilot of the first field test of NASA's Space Exploration Vehicle, a concept pressurized rover for future moon and Mars exploration. He held over 30 expeditions to the Arctic and Antarctic for comparative studies between the Earth and Mars, including a 402-day winter over in Antarctica as chief geoscientist. Yes, pretty impressive. As chief geoscientist at Dumont d'Urville Station. I hope I pronounced that correctly.
Close enough.
Close enough. That'll work for today. He also led the Northwest Passage Drive expedition, a record-setting vehicular transverse on sea ice along the FAB-led Northwest Passage in the Arctic. The journey is the subject of an award-winning motion picture documentary film, Passage to Mars, which came out in 2016. And he is also the recipient of the United States Antarctic Service Medal and of several NASA Group Achievement Awards. He's an advisor to NASA and an artist member of the International Association of Astronomical Artists and the author of Mission Mars Scholastic, a children's book on the human exploration of Mars. So, welcome our esteemed panelists. Thank you all for being here. And I think to get things started, we'll start off with a little background from Dr. Ehrenberg. So let me click to your presentation.
So at first look, what I'll call Hollywood in space would appear to have little in common. And hopefully when I'm done with my very brief prepared comments, I'll change. Excuse me?
I think Siri didn't get that.
So. Oh, Siri didn't get that.
Siri wasn't comprehending yet. Went
awesome.
Over her head.
I stumped the machine right out of the box. Okay,
exactly.
I'm done. I can go home now.
Go home now. Pack your bags.
And I hope to show that both of these endeavors share a great deal of commonality, being founded on collaboration, highly innovative endeavors. So my job is to invent the future, at least insofar as space science missions at Northrop are concerned. No matter what the scale of the problem, be it an entire mission, or series of missions, or a very detailed, subtle engineering problem, all those solutions start with imagination and rely heavily on communication, whether I'm competing for funds or I'm trying to convince managers and colleagues to sign on to a particular solution. And so engineering at its heart is very practical art, but has strong roots in creativity, communication, and collaboration. Over the last dozen years, I've been assigned to work NASA's James Webb Space Telescope, where we at Northrop are very proud to lead the industrial team implementing this amazing machine. It's intended to see the first luminous objects, understand the formation of galaxies, take data to understand the birth of stars and planets, and examine bodies in the solar system and around other stars for indications of habitability and other scientific advances. Amazingly enough, it's due to launch late next year. As chief engineer, one of my jobs is to communicate this amazing machine, and I get to communicate everywhere from preschoolers to Nobel laureates and everything in between. And to tell this story, I have to rely on my knowledge to curate the discussion for the appropriate audience and then explain it in a manner appropriate to that audience. I completely agree with Albert Einstein, who said, if you can't explain it to a six-year-old, you don't understand it. So on the second slide, you'll see the first four images of a sextet of images showing the evolution of the design. It also indicates another commonality between storytelling in engineering and storytelling in Hollywood, the need to take a bit of artistic license. You can easily see the telescope, but I assure you when it operates a million miles away from Earth, it will be in Stygian darkness. Otherwise, it won't be able to detect the very faint signals from the beginning of time. And so we have to take a little bit of license in order to tell a compelling story. When we move on to the next slide, we get to another area of commonality. which is storytelling with moving pictures. It was my job to discuss not only the evolution of the design, which is shown in the last two images on the top, but you see the credits from a 12-minute movie that evolved from a silent feature to a talkie, and I had to become director and screenwriter and recruiter, and I recruited in a very L.A. story my brother, who's in front of the camera talent. You've seen him on Once Upon a Time and Pirates of the Caribbean. Not only did I get an appreciation for how hard my colleagues in Hollywood have to work to produce a product, but I did get my brother to work for below scale. So I am, in addition to a storyteller, ultimately an engineer. As we go on to the last slide, you know, this is the ultimate product. This is the James Webb Space Telescope. This picture was taken very recently. This is the hardware that will fly a million miles away from Earth. The culmination of this effort is truly epic. It represents the completion of over 100 million person hours of effort spread over about 30 years to bring this to fruition and launch in 2018. So in this case, I've shown you the circle of life, if you will, of a project from imagination, early design, evolution, increase in aesthetic, to finally realization. So I hope I've given you a little bit to chew on and seeded the conversation for my colleagues, and I look forward to our discussion.
Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about getting ready for Mars. And, you know, nobody goes to space alone. This is just something we probably don't think about, but nobody goes to space alone. If you're not alone in the space capsule, you've got a huge amount of support staff behind you, making sure that that voyage is going to be safe and productive for you. But even before that, you have lots and lots of people thinking about all the aspects of what's going to happen when you're on that voyage. NASA is especially concerned about long-duration spaceflight missions, as those that will be going to Mars or to the asteroids. So they started looking at what would it take to build a very rudimentary holodeck for this kind of space travel. We'll go to the second slide. Because this is really what is going to be seen when you're on your way to Mars. Not much. There's going to be some stars out there, but it's not like you're in the ISS where you can go up to that cupola and look at the gorgeous Earth right there below you, you know, passing over it. You're going to have a lot of monotony, sensory monotony. And the other thing you're going to have is social isolation. Even if you have a crew of five other people with you, so there are six of you crammed in this tiny tin can, you are still going to wish you had other people you could talk to. And that, coupled with the fact that you will not have synchronous communication. It's not like the ISS where you can have a video call with your family every day. You will have at least a 20-minute delay each way. So what are we going to do about this? Let's see the next slide. We came up with this idea for NASA to create something called ANSIBLE, which is actually an acronym about thing for bilateral life enhancement, but we really like the sci-fi connection. And the idea would be that we provide, using virtual reality, provide aspects that can help people going to Mars deal with the issues of sensory monotony and social isolation that they will undoubtedly have to deal with. So we wanted to test this in something that was reminiscent of the kind of habitat that they would have on some place like Mars. So we were able to put it in the high seas habitat, next slide, on Mauna Loa in the Big Island of Hawaii. Now, this is what they call a Mars analog, and it runs totally on solar power, composting toilets. There's not a lot of space in there. It's about 1,000 square foot geodesic dome with a few boxcars around it. They do have a washing machine in there, and they have a kitchen. But this is a place where six volunteer scientists were sequestered for a full year with no real-time communication with anybody back on Earth. They said they were on Mars, so they didn't have that kind of communication, and they had a lot of sensory monotony because, you know what, Hawaii, this mountain especially, looks a lot like Mars. Now, an interesting story about the creation of this habitat, this Mars analog habitat, is that NASA was designing, helping to design this habitat, which is run by the University of Hawaii. And they had these big plans, and it was becoming very expensive. And there was a guy on the island who was very interested in sustainable architecture, had made a lot of money through the video game Tetris back in the day, and said, you know what? I can build this thing for you with kind of off-the-shelf parts, and it'll cost a tenth of what you're trying to make. And so Hank Rogers did. He built this thing. And it really is boxcars and some carpentry inside that geodesic dome so that they each scientist had their own individual cubicle about as big as a table here. And, you know, they had spaces to exercise, but they didn't have a lot of space. Let's do the next slide. So we gave them, here's an actual picture of it. The whiteness did bother some of the locals, so they put a camouflage tent over it. I think, let's do the next slide. We gave them ways to deal with the isolation. We gave them things like using virtual reality to go on nature walks, for meditation. We brought in AI agents to add variety to some of the areas. We gave them places where they could build things. And we gave them an interesting technique which allowed them to record their avatars doing something and leaving a message that their friends and family back on Earth could access on the days when the friends and family could go in there. So this was a totally asynchronous system. There was a server in the habitat that the scientists could log into on Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, and there was a server in California where family from all over the world and friends could log in on Monday, Wednesday, Friday. So never in at the same time. But they could leave these recordings of their avatars. This was the picture on the lower left was a Thanksgiving table that we set up. So they could leave recordings of their avatars saying what they were thankful for. And then when the other side came in, they could play all those things. We thought they'd use that for singing Happy Birthday, too, but they didn't do that one. So go ahead to the next slide. So this project ran for a year. We had a control group in a previous high seas isolation study that was only in for 8 months, and that was our control group. And compared to them, this group actually was better psychologically than the previous group. We think this had a little bit to do with it, the fact that they were able to escape the confines of this very confined space, and that they could do things outside the context of those six individuals. An interesting thing about putting scientists into a habitat like that is it's a good way to test out, just like the Antarctica habitats and things like that, it's a good way to test out what works. And one of the scientists who was sequestered for that year was actually a student getting his PhD at the University of Hawaii in Mars habitat designs. And so I dare say he learned a lot. We were hoping he would be here today, but he just finished up that PhD, but I think we'll be hearing a lot more from him because he has a lot of practical advice on how to build these things in a way that can add not only to sort of the benefits of designing that space to take into account the psychological issues, but also for practical knowledge that says maybe we can make it better a little bit if we just change this.
Great. Okay, so now we're going to take a few questions from the audience, and then during that time I'll get Pete's presentation set up and moving from there. But if you have questions right now for Dr. Ehrenberg or Dr. Mari, we welcome those, and then we'll hear from Dr. Pascal and Pete.
Do you want us to acknowledge,
yes,
Connie, while you're busy?
Yes,
okay,
please.
Phil? Most of what I know in the private space industry are not, they're not designing sort of the habitats, they're designing the space of the actual spacecraft and trying to make that as ergonomically beneficial as possible. But NASA has a big group designing the habitats, and then there are other individuals. I'm not aware of any space industry that's actually looking at design of the habitats for Mars.
The trip to Mars, for example.
Sorry?
The trip to Mars that people are talking about,
the
one-way trip.
Oh, I think there's a bunch of stuff they're going to send up there and then have to put together. I'm not sure how far along in the design concepts that is. I'm hoping there's somebody working on that. Sorry?
Home Depot.
IKEA. Yeah, I think it'll be IKEA on Mars.
Yes.
Wow, I think that's an exponential thing. You make a bigger ship, you got a lot of science to do to get it off the ground and get it there. And even then, it's probably not going to be big enough to live in, I would guess. You could build it in space. I mean, that's what we did with the ISS, right? There's a lot of good cubby holes and little nooks and crannies in the ISS. I was going to say
Let me just.
Yeah.
Sure. Currently, just to have a ballpark, it costs about $1 million to put a kilogram on Mars.
Yeah.
So, sure, you can do bigger. But.
Wow.
So actually, a lot of people are. Well, I know of teams that are looking at using local resources to create brick, for example, brick materials. Since there's a lot of clays on Mars, you can actually bake bricks. And so you set up a small outpost to get going, and then you grow from local materials into a bigger habitat.
Yeah, and you did 3D printing and reuse the materials as needed.
The early missions will likely be faced with a very confined environment.
Yes. Yeah.
And this is why virtual reality is important, because it can expand the space psychologically, even if not physically. Well, I think I have to fault Star Trek for one thing. They set a damn high bar for that holodeck. We don't have anything near that technology right now, especially in terms of the haptics where you could actually sit on a chair. I always say we have to invent some new technology like the nanomolecular display that actually takes atoms and recombines them into, this shape and that table and that chair that you can then sit on. But it's not likely we're going to have that in a small spacecraft going to Mars at, what was it, per kilogram?
Roughly a million.
Yeah. So maybe they'll build it there. Maybe, those were Starfleet ships. Those were giant ships. So they had room for holodecks. Right now, I think we're going to have a little headset, and that's going to be pretty much it.
Thank you.
I think it's 50 to 100 years out, myself, to actually do a real, real holodeck that doesn't require encumbering equipment and actually gives you the physics of reality. I think we're getting there. We have things that do partial stuff, but we don't have the haptics figured out. We don't have a lot of other senses figured out, and energy, matter transfer, and all that good stuff. I think we're pretty far away from a real holodeck. That's why I said Star Trek set the bar a little high. Thank you, Hollywood.
Okay, so we're going to go back to Pete now, and then we'll go back to the audience questions. So, Pete, we've got your slides ready to go.
So my story is a little bit. At the Rogue Initiative, we are definitely in the place where we're marrying Hollywood storytelling with technology. We're all geeks, we're all designers, we're all engineers. We come from that background of technology, but we also have some Hollywood chops. So we partner with some filmmakers, and we're really looking at everything we can to augment storytelling, whether it's AR, VR, mixed reality, Lytro camera, you name it, anything that can make storytelling more compelling and mitigate production costs and so forth. Along those lines, though, we also happen to be partnered with some amazing filmmakers, Michael Vandenberg and some others, and they come with their own set of brands and their own sensibilities that are very much in line with what we love and enjoy and are passionate about in the sci-fi and technology world. So it goes very much in line with kind of my experience. I was on the Call of Duty franchise for many, many years, back when it kind of went from World War II to Modern Warfare, and we kind of gave it a reboot. But a lot of that took us to a place where we had to start envisioning what life would be like in orbit, and what could we fight over, right? So unfortunately, in video games and in entertainment, you have to add a little bit of drama. So for us, it meant creating giant structures like this, and we can jump to another slide. It's out of order. One more. And so, weapons in space, and how do we control them? How do we fight over them? How do we protect them? And the next one, you can jump through these. And then finding reasons why we have to have, unfortunately, soldiers in space, these kinds of things like we see here. And then the last slide. So a lot of how we design things like this to work in a game or in a film, of course, kind of go against the things that we learn from scientists, such as people on this panel. And so we take a lot of these things in. We work with scientists all the time. We have three projects right now that are all very sci-fi driven. One's very grounded. Two are very much a little on the fantastical side. But my point in all this is to kind of just be here to say, we certainly take a lot of this in, and we learn from it, and we keep it grounded and plausible, and then start adding the layers of the fantasy and the entertainment. So there's a place in the middle. So that's kind of us, project we're working on right now. So a brand new game about Call of Duty that we're putting together now. So of course, working with lots of scientists and physicists and really smart people on how to create this fiction for this new IP we're working on. So that's me.
Great, thank you. And last but not least.
I was told five slides too, but then I thought it was just an order of magnitude. So. I'm very grateful as a scientist to Hollywood because I feel that I owe my interest in space exploration and the sort of the appeal of the unknown out there from my childhood to watching Hollywood movies and, of course, TV shows. So it's sort of an interesting opportunity for me to be here today to sort of comment on what we are planning for the future of the real future of space exploration and habitation, and at the same time, how Hollywood can maybe help us envision this future. There's always a fine line between fantasy and vision. Fantasy, is sort of boundless. It's Star Wars is fantasy because you're not even going to comment on why spacecraft make sounds when they're in deep space. Because so many other laws of physics are violated in Star Wars anyway. But vision, on the other hand, is something that might apply to, 2001, A Space Odyssey. So I just want to say a couple more things on past movies, and then I'll talk about the future.
Okay.
Next, please. So space is silent, okay? And this is really something that, I used to not care as a kid, but now that I watch science fiction movies, through the eyes of a scientist, since there's no air and no atmosphere in deep space, there's no way for sound to propagate. And so therefore, when you see a spacecraft sort of entering your screen from the top and cruising through space, it should be silent. And even if it's portraying the rumbling that you would hear from the inside of the ship, which that would be okay. Sometimes when you shift to the inside view, actually there's a muffled sound, so therefore what was shown before was actually the outside sound, which actually should not exist. Okay, so Alien, as you know, it had a sort of a subtitle. It said, in space no one can hear you scream, and as far as spacecraft in general, I added, in space no one should hear spaceships either. Okay, all right, next slide. Now, 2001, A Space Odyssey remains, from my perspective, still the most accurate, technically accurate, physically grounded science fiction movie ever made. And what I'm going to say here is not a criticism of the movie at all. It's more that, in spite of how accurate it is, there are some bizarreness to the reality of space and physics that were not even explored in the movie. And I want to comment on that particular point. In one of the famous scenes in the movie is you see this astronaut running in this spinning section of the spacecraft. And because there's centrifugal force, the astronaut is able to essentially stay against the wall, if you will, of the wheel and rotates along with that spinning part of the spaceship. And if you look at the diagram on the left at the bottom, if you're just standing there in contact with the ground, you're just going to be stuck to the ground and feeling some gravity because of the centrifugal force. Okay. Now, if you start running in the direction in which the station is spinning, your centrifugal force will actually increase because now you are rotating even faster around the axis of rotation. And so the running person who runs in the direction of the rotation will actually feel heavier and heavier. Okay. Now, of course, that's subtle. And that was not portrayed in the movie. But what's really interesting is that if you run in the opposite direction, and that wasn't explored in the movie at all, but it's depicted in the last image there on the top right, you might actually run so fast that you could compensate the rotation movement of the space of the station itself. In other words, you could cancel your rotational speed in reference relative to the axis of rotation, and at that point you become weightless. So you can launch yourself into weightlessness by just running against the rotation direction of your station. And so there's an extraordinary environment and dynamics of artificial gravity that remains to be explored in the next science fiction movie that would actually portray artificial gravity in a wheel. So those of you who are inclined to do something that's going to be really right on, that could be really fun. All right, next slide. So let's talk about Mars, because that's what I've been mostly focused on and what NASA, of course, is aiming for in the decades to come. It's an incredible planet, next slide, but there's a harsh reality about it. It's really a place that looks, you know, like Arizona, but there's nothing like Arizona other than maybe the landscape. On the right, I have listed for you from top to bottom the five things that will kill you on Mars in chronological order of cause of death if you were not protected by a spacesuit or habitat. So the first thing is the very low atmospheric pressure. The surface pressure on Mars is what you have on Earth at an altitude of 100,000 feet. Wow. So if you just walk into 100,000 feet type of thin air, your blood would essentially boil. All the oxygen and nitrogen that's dissolved in your bloodstream right now would essentially turn into, would fizz. You would fizz to death, like popping a can of Coke, okay? So that will kill you in seconds. If that didn't kill you, you cannot breathe the atmosphere. It's made of CO2, so that will kill you in minutes. If that didn't kill you, the temperatures will. The average temperature on Mars is minus 80 degrees Fahrenheit, so that will kill you in a matter of hours, and you turn into a huge, into a human popsicle. If that didn't kill you, the dust is very toxic, fine grain, so it's going to clog the pores of your lungs, and abrasive, so it's going to tear up the tissues of your lungs. In the movie The Martian, the last thing you want to do is scoop Martian dust and bring it into the cabin where you live, okay? Because the potatoes that you grow out of that soil will be toxic as well, since the soil itself is toxic. It's got perchlorates and peroxides, so you would have contaminated potatoes. You would die in a matter of weeks from eating those kinds of potatoes. And no amount of pooping in the Martian soil will fix that problem. And then finally, if that didn't kill you, over a matter of months, you would die of exposure to space radiation. Even though it's somewhat less at the surface of Mars than in deep space, you're still exposed because Mars does not have a thick atmosphere nor does it have a magnetic field. Okay, so we here on Earth are not exposed to space radiation thanks to those two things, a thick atmosphere and a magnetic field. We're like on Starship Enterprise here, the shields are up. But on Mars, you don't have the benefit of that. Okay. Now, these are five causes of death that could be really made spectacular in the next realistic movie about, you know, a mission on Mars. Okay, so next slide. So where do we go simulate Mars? Jackie just mentioned to you the work in Hawaii. We've been focusing our studies mostly on this incredible site called Devon Island, and NASA does work in other places as well around the world. Devon Island is in the Canadian Arctic. It's beyond the Arctic Circle. It's very close to the North Pole. It's one of the last islands you run into before you get to the North Pole. And Devon is the largest uninhabited island on Earth. It's about the size of West Virginia. Like the West Virginia, it's almost uninhabited. You are the population of Devon when you are there. And we go there because it's in a part of the Arctic that's very cold and dry, to first order, somewhat like Mars. And there's a giant meteorite crater there called Houghton Crater. Okay, next slide. So we've been going up there for the past 20 years. In fact, this coming summer when we head up there, it'll be our 21st year, of going up there. This is our permanent base. It's like a mini Mars base. Next slide. And I want to comment now on a few general lessons learned and things for you to consider next time you do a flick that sort of portrays the space habitat on Mars. This is taken directly from my little children's book, so forgive the simplicity of the diagram, but I just wanted to illustrate a few points. Next slide. So, you know, this is an example of a Mars habitat that would be in the form of a single landed large vehicle. There are other options to do this. In this case, you have three decks. And one thing to note is that there's going to be a gradient in cleanliness from the top to the bottom. The bottom deck is where you bring in the rocks, where you have your spacesuits, your airlocks, your ATVs coming in and out. It's going to be very gritty. It might be where you have your rock labs and where maybe you're even looking for Martian life in the soil. Once you go upstairs to the middle deck, to the mid deck, things sort of clean up a little bit. You are in your regular living quarters. And then in the top deck, you are in the zone where you're spending your hours sleeping and where you might have all your computers. And so you're going to want to have a very clean environment up there. A few other things to consider. Martian gravity is 0.38 g, so 38% of what it is on the Earth. So the acceleration of gravity is somewhat slower. If you turn on the tap, you will actually see the water slowly fall, okay, as opposed to just hitting the bottom of the sink, you know, almost immediately like it does on the Earth. You can jump 2.6 times higher on Mars than on the Earth. So you could, with a good jump, jump from one deck to the next. Okay, you might need to help yourself with your hands. We put the water tanks at the very top because the hydrogen from the water will do a bit of shielding from space radiation. But also you can make use of gravity to have running water, just like we do on Earth with water towers. Okay. Anyway, there's quite a bit of physics in all this, and that's buried in sort of how you might design a habitat like this. Next slide. Most of our work has been focusing, however, on spacesuits and rovers, and I just want to go through this real quick. The current spacesuit we have is a beautiful piece of aerospace engineering. You should realize, of course, that a spacesuit is not just clothing. It's a wearable spacecraft. And so it's an engineering marvel. It has life support systems, computers, radios, information displays, waste management, cooling systems, temperature regulation in general. Very complex piece of space hardware. This piece of hardware weighs 300 pounds on the Earth. If you take it to the moon, where gravity is only six times less, it has a felt weight on your back of 50 pounds, 300 divided by 6, 50 pounds. So that's manageable. If you take the same spacesuit to Mars, it will have a felt weight of 125 pounds. You cannot do field work with that on your back. So we're faced with a real technical challenge when we go to Mars, which is to create a spacesuit that on Earth would weigh no more than 150 pounds, so half the mass. You've got to cut the mass of this thing in half before you have a spacesuit on Mars that's viable for doing field work. That's a big challenge because this thing is already lean and mean. Next slide. On top of that, so we've been working on solutions to bring down the weight, the mass of the suit on Devon Island while doing field work, while putting it through the motions of actual geological exploration. Next slide. We also have to bear in mind that there are features on Mars that are going to require a lot of flexibility for your suit, like rock climbing. Next slide. There are canyons. Next slide. There are dust storms, which you don't have on the moon. Dust will, next slide, impinge on your spacesuit. This is yours truly doing a wind tunnel dust storm exposure test in the spacesuit, exposing spacesuit fabric. You can see that the little grains of dust, so it's actually volcanic dust from Hawaii and mixed with kitty litter, will create little craters in your spacesuit fabric. Okay, so we have a challenge here with wear and tear. Next slide. Okay, and then we have to bear in mind that Mars is not just rocks as well. It's a lot of sand, and you know we may have to have a suit that's really good for floating, if you will, not allowing you to sink into sand in every step. So we do tests in the Mojave Desert as well at Dumont Dunes. Which is actually a place you could access easily from here if you want to go film sort of a canonical Mars landscape. Next slide. So in the end, the suit looks like this. It's blue. Unlike in the movie The Martian, you do not want to blend into the landscape. You want to be visible. In the movie The Martian, the spacesuit is orange. I'm not sure why. I guess it looks better, maybe. The spacesuit is blue because it's the complementary color to orange. This is something that Chesley Bonsdale, in his early paintings from the Disney days, figured out already. Thick boots, gaiters that wrap around your lower legs that are interchangeable, smartphone on your wrist to get data and take selfies. It's a rear entry suit, so you see the upper torso is rigid because it's going to need to be very strong since you're doing a lot of spacewalks on Mars, and it's a rear entry suit. So you enter the spacesuit by opening the backpack. The backpack swings open like a refrigerator door, and you climb in feet first. Your feet go all the way down to the boots. Then you put on your headset, then you insert your arms into the arms, and then you close the backpack behind you. Okay, and now you're sealed in this shell that is your wearable spacesuit, your wearable spacecraft. All right, so basic features for the Mars suit. Next slide. As far as getting around, we think that for short distances, you're going to want an ATV. Next slide. And that's because the ATV is turning into the best solution we can think of to really lighten the spacesuit. All right, we're going to offload onto the ATV the heavy oxygen tanks, the big oxygen tanks, the big batteries that are normally in the backpack, onto an ATV. So while you're driving your ATV, you're recharging your spacesuit. Your spacesuit has smaller oxygen tanks, smaller batteries. And then you can, once you get to an interesting place, you want to collect rocks, you step off, and now you are, you know, staying close to your ATV, of course, but you are carrying a much lighter spacesuit. And then bear in mind that your ATV is robotic, so it's going to follow you. It's not going to just stay parked, you know, 100 meters behind you. It will follow you like R2-D2, okay? You can talk to it, it can go fetch, it can, you know, do things for you. And of course, you're still not alone with this thing. So you're no longer like on Apollo, you know, the exploration system was the human being and the spacesuit. Now the exploration system is the human being, the spacesuit, and the ATV. And that becomes sort of the exploration unit. You're still not alone, so you have a buddy maybe with you. If his or her ATV breaks down, he or she can jump onto your ATV. They just remove that box at the back of your ATV, which has spare parts. In an emergency, you don't need spare parts. You're just going to try to get home. And there's a rear-facing seat that's exposed at that point. And so the person that you're rescuing can also connect onto the reserve oxygen and battery supplies and stay alive all the way back home. Okay, so that's sort of the concept that we've come up with. And you know, I've yet to see this in any sci-fi movie for short-range exploration. Next slide. As far as longer distance trips are concerned, we are already familiar with this concept. It's a pressurized rover. So it's sort of the motorhome concept of traveling on Mars or the moon, for that matter. You are living inside in shirt sleeves, and you put on a spacesuit only to go outside. It's sort of a submarine on wheels, and you explore in the comfort of a pressurized interior. Okay. Next slide. So I've actually was lucky enough to be the first scientist to test drive this contraption designed by NASA in Houston. It's called the Space Exploration Vehicle, and it's an amazing vehicle. It has the wheels are all independently rotatable, and so you can configure them in a circle, and the whole thing does a circle on the spot, on the dime, over at CG, and turns around. It has a turning radius of zero. And then of course the visibility that you have inside, it's like being in a helicopter that's in a stable hover. Okay, so you just, you know. It's not intended to go fast. It can go up to 25 miles per hour, and you know, that's probably, if you were on salt flats on Mars, you might allow yourself to go that fast, but otherwise you're typically going to be at 5 to 10 miles an hour. Next slide. Otherwise mission control is going to freak out, even they are, 3 to 20 minutes away. This is the interior. If you are right-handed, you sit on the right and you joystick it from the right. If you are left-handed, you sit on the left, you joystick it from the left. This is when all those hours of video gaming might actually pay off. All right, next slide. Now, the movie The Martian. I actually know Andy Weir really well, and he's a super smart guy, so we tease each other with, what's right or wrong about the story. But this pressurized rover has several problems. It's very angular in shape, when in fact it should be a pressure vessel, just like your propane tank and underneath your barbecue is rounded. Okay, you do not want an angular-looking pressurized rover. But the other thing is, this guy, every time he goes in and out of the habitat of this rover, he has to swing open the big door, and all the oxygen rushes out. It's lost. Meanwhile, oxygen is a real premium on Mars, or anywhere for that matter. You don't want to be wasteful like this. On top of that, he's going in and out of this cabin with his dusty, dirty spacesuit. You don't want to do that either, because again, the dust is toxic, and over time, it's going to, be really bad news for you. And then I've mentioned this already: the suit is orange. So, next slide. This is how you do it. You have a rounded, pressurized rover, and the spacesuits are docked to the back wall of the rover through suit ports. Okay, so this is the same suit we were looking at just earlier. It's a rear entry suit. You can enter the suit directly from the inside of the rover by swinging open the backpack into the rover. Okay, and now at no point does the spacesuit come into the habitat where you're living. The dust is not brought in. There's a tiny bit of dust on the backpack, but you can vacuum that off, and then you are clean to enter or egress. Okay. So that's how you do it. And of course, you are not wasting the entire cabin's oxygen when you're doing this. It's a very lean, mean approach to doing EVAs. Next slide. So that's how you might do a pull-up to climb into your spacesuit from the inside of the rover. This is astronaut Rex Walheim demonstrating how to do this. And if you think that doing a pull-up is going to be difficult, well, don't forget that you're in Martian gravity. So you might be able to do it with, a finger. Not quite, but it's going to be easier. Next slide. And then this thing can drive at night, either itself or by mission control. Imagine exploring a place during the day, and then you're done with your spacesuit walk. You climb back inside. You cook dinner. You ride home. You go to bed, and while you're sleeping, this thing moves on to the next place, okay? And so the next morning, you draw the curtains, and hey, you are at the edge of the canyon. It's a new day of exploration, okay? And again, this whole idea of a journey on Mars has never been, or on any planet, sort of a road trip has never really been portrayed in film yet. So, next slide. So on Devon Island, we don't have the SEV. We just have Humvees that we use for this purpose. Next slide. In fact, a movie documentary just came out last fall about the journey of one of our Humvees. We actually drove it all the way to Devon Island on sea ice, and so that was more epic than we wanted it to be. But anyway, it made for a documentary story. So you can catch it on gowatchit.com, and there are different options to view it online or get the DVD. Next slide. Now, I'll just end with very quick two points. One is that something historic happened at NASA about a year and a half ago. For the first time in NASA's history, scientists and engineers were convened together to propose landing sites for humans on Mars. This had never been done before. When you start looking at different landing sites, you get the sense that it's actually potentially going to happen. And so 50 sites were proposed. They're still in play. We haven't narrowed them down. I led a team that proposed Noctis Landing, which is near canyons, but also near the volcanoes of Mars. Next slide. Here's the site. It's relatively flat where you land. And of course, you have immediately access to amazing country, canyons and volcanoes. Next slide. Since this is touching on virtual reality, we actually use just Google Mars. I don't know if you know this, but if you go to Google Earth, there's a little icon at the very top that's actually a little planet Saturn that nobody ever explores. But if you drop the menu from that little icon, you'll see that there's a Google Moon and there's a Google Mars. And all of Mars is mapped onto a globe, and you can explore Mars just like you explore the Earth, okay, on Google Mars. Anyway, we can land anywhere we want, look at the landscape. This is sort of the street view of our landing site on Mars. And hopefully, if NASA does end up picking this one, it's going to be a spectacular place with canyons on the horizon and a flat area in the foreground for you to explore safely. In a very short term, this is my second and last point. We're going to probably explore the moons of Mars. They're much easier to get to. You don't have all the complexity of landing on Mars. These are little worlds compared to even our moon. Phobos is about the size of Manhattan Island. Gravity on Phobos is 1,700 times less than on the Earth. If you push yourself on your feet, you will slowly rise to about half a mile on Phobos, okay, and then slowly fall back down. And then when you hit the ground again, it won't be harder than when you push yourself off. It'd be an amazing place to explore. And of course, Phobos being the closer one to Mars, you'd have a glorious view of Mars. Phobos is 42 times closer to Mars than our moon is to the Earth. Okay, next slide. That's the final slide. So this is what using jetpacks to explore Phobos might look like when you're in orbit around Mars. Late 2020s, early 2030s. Also okay. Never depicted in film.
Awesome. Thank you. So we'll take a couple questions from the audience. Yes?
Yeah. Kevlar is in the mix. It's part of the things that we're looking into. But it's probably a little more porous than you would want, Kevlar. Yeah, I mean, carbon fiber actually is what we're essentially looking at, and the range of those. And the reason why you want that upper torso to be rigid, by the way, it's because it's hanging on that suit port. And while the rover's bouncing around, you don't want to have a sort of a soft shell suit to be torn over time. Okay, you want something rigid. Yes. We're flying a drone for the second summer, this coming summer, so we're going to have things to show. That's also in the mix. Drones on Mars are tricky because the atmospheric density is so low, it's 100 times less dense than here. So the way to generate the same amount of lift, you either have to, you know, double your surface area or spin your rotors 10 times faster. So it's a challenge to fly on Mars, but it's possible, and we think of using drones as a scout, of course, you know, teleoperated from the inside of the rover to make sure whatever's ahead is safe. Yeah.
So I know we have a just a couple more minutes, so I just wanted to ask a couple of questions to some of our other panelists. John, I know you were talking to earlier about the Webb telescope. Can you tell us about, I know Dr. Lee was just talking about the environment and the drones on Mars and the ability to travel in that environment. Can you tell us a little bit about the ability for such a large spacecraft to be able to travel a million miles away from Earth and maintain that orbit and what that orbit is when it goes out that far?
Sure. Our orbit is around the second Lagrange point, which is one of the five points in the Earth's orbit around the Sun that maintains its orientation, relative position to the Earth. We're a million miles anti-sunward, so four times the distance to the moon away. And if you were to look up essentially every night anti-sunward, you'd see our satellite essentially hanging in the sky. And that's a very unique place because we can put the sun, the earth, and the moon all on one side of our sun shield and put the telescope on the dark far side. And so, you know, in cosmic terms, it's much easier to get to than Mars. It's less than a month's travel. I know a million miles sounds like a lot, whether it's a lot of frequent flyer miles or a lot of trips or however you want to put it. But in cosmic terms, it's very close. It's only 5 seconds by radio and less than a month by conventional rocket. So it's the new hot property for space science.
And so in, with that hot property of space science, Pete, I know John was talking earlier about that with the telescope, and if you really depicted it, it would always be in, it would be dark, right? You wouldn't be able to see it. So as a creative director, how do you take creative license and maintain flexibility in telling stories like that, trying to be accurate but yet exciting? Because it may not be as exciting to depict it in complete darkness, right? So how does that world work for you?
That's a good question. Yeah, how to get it out of that, you know. I think we talked about this earlier about watching the wobble and watching we have to take those things and take them into consideration, and then what we talked about earlier was how do you add that the thing doesn't exist, that Heisenberg compensator, if you will, or something to make it seem a little more flashy, a little more visual. Mm-hmm. You know, again, I think people realize when we talk about audio, audio plays so much into movies, and then you're absolutely right, though. You cannot have audio in there. It's the same problem.
Right.
So you have to add things like that just to add some sort of visceral feel to it, because the science alone is very compelling. A lot of times when we think about that, we have to figure out what makes something really, really unique and stand out. For example, Interstellar, when they extrapolated what a black hole would look like, and that completely revisualized what those things we think they would look like. And
right.
So that was really the... If you look at that movie, that was something that's iconic now for that film. And so we look at those things and try to figure out, if this makes sense, like what is it about that could be very flashy or very visceral to add to the science and hopefully not corrupt it too much, keep it plausible.
Right.
It's a rather abstract answer, but it's something for each individual case, something we have to look at. And how do we make it sexy? Because it's all about sexing it up, right?
Right. Got to do what you got to do.
Yeah.
Dr. Mari, how do you, so Pete gave examples of live action films, right, with Interstellar and things of that nature. Do you still try to keep the plausibility when you're working in a virtual reality world? And if so, how are you managing that, but still, again, being exciting and accurate?
I think they try and get it as bright as it makes sense for someone having an experience. And I'm not talking about the ones that are used by scientists or astronauts right now, but for example, there's a company called Fusion that is doing a wonderful educational VR thing for what it would be like if you were living on Mars. And there's all these habitats that have different functions. There are different kinds of laboratories. You can go out on rovers and grab rocks and bring them in and crack them in the different laboratories. And this is all in virtual reality. So it takes a good, you know, 40 minutes to go through everything that they've got there right now. They've got lava tubes, and they've got some interesting things, the sexing it up kind of stuff. The lava tubes, you can press a button or enable a function that takes you back, you know, 4 billion years to when the lava tubes were full of lava.
No,
you know, and it doesn't hurt you, so that's good. And it's very sexy looking. So I think, you know, it depends on what your motivation is for that. So if it's education, this is really good for education. If it's learning how to live in a particular real environment that is going to be dangerous beyond belief for you, then you have other things that you want to emphasize. If it's going to be for entertainment, you want that entertainment value. And if it's going to be for something that enlightens us for years to come, you want to make sure that it's rock solid engineering.
Yeah, definitely. Well, thank you all. I know we're getting close to time. Yeah. I'm sorry. Okay, yeah, I know we're getting we're out of time now, but I'm sure if you have additional questions, you can come up and have a chance to chat with our panelists. I'll also end with our note. I know Dr. Lee was talking about the documentary film. We also have a documentary film called Into the Unknown with the James Webb Space Telescope, and so you can go and look at that for educational purposes and entertainment purposes on our Northrop Grumman website, so we invite you to continue to follow the story of the James Webb Space Telescope and watching that documentary film, Into the Unknown. Thank you all for coming out. We appreciate it. We hope you enjoyed the panel.
Thank you.